Now that we inspected, palpated, and auscultated the area in question, one thing to consider as well, when you auscultate, when you auscultate, you have to consider the area in question. Now, if you have somebody with shoulder pain, you're not going to auscultate the shoulder. If somebody with abdominal pain, technically, yes, you can auscultate the abdomen, listen to gastric sounds. However, for an EMT and even for me as a paramedic, it's not really applicable. Okay? So you could do it, but you would have to know what exactly you're listening for and how to report it. The nurse, the doctor, everyone in the hospital is going to reassess that anyways. So you can go ahead and skip that part for like the abdomen, for example, and just do the inspection and the palpation. We're going to move on to our vital signs. This is the part where you're going to go ahead and take your full set of vital signs. Now, for certain types of chief complaints or conditions, let's say for a diabetic patient, possibly you're going to do a blood glucose assessment. You're going to be doing that a little bit quicker, possibly in the sample history in your S, your signs and symptoms. So you may have to prioritize your vital signs. Somebody with shortness of breath, one of the first few vital signs you're going to get is lung sounds and an O2 sat, respiratory rate, and then followed by your blood pressure and all your other vital signs. So you're going to have to prioritize your vital signs. Your field impression. This is where you have completed the entire assessment, obtained as much information as possible. Now, you're going to come up with what's called a working diagnosis. Now, officially, we do not diagnose. Officially, we do not diagnose. That's for a medical doctor. That's for a physician and other higher-level practitioners, PAs, nurse practitioners. They're going to go ahead and make that diagnosis. However, we need something to work with. In other words, what are we treating with this patient? So your field impression, you're going to go ahead and state the patient's age, now that you have obtained it, their sex, chief complaint. So I have, let's say, a 90-year-old male with chest pain. My possible working diagnosis, DX means diagnosis. The question mark means possible. So possible diagnosis. Okay? So we have to come up with an unofficial diagnosis. So in other words, my 90-year-old male with chest pain, I believe that this patient's having some type of cardiac event, some type of cardiac compromise. Now, I'm not necessarily saying they're exactly having myocardial infarction, a heart attack. However, they're having some type of cardiac event. In other words, this isn't just a cold, this isn't just a cough. My assessment revealed that this patient's having a cardiac event. Based on this cardiac event, I'm going to list my treatment plan. My treatment plan for this patient that's having a cardiac event, I want to assist them with their nitroglycerin, administer aspirin, and continue the oxygen that they're already on if they're on oxygen. So I'm going to go ahead and get my treatment plan in place. Now my intervention, this is where we put it into an actual action. In regards to medications that an EMT would assist or administer, we're going to go ahead and look at the order. For example, for nitroglycerin, you have a standing order, meaning you can do it without contacting medical direction. I have a standing order to assist up to 3 doses, including what the patient took prior to arrival. So if the patient took 1 prior to our arrival, because we found out with interventions prior to arrival, I know that I can assist up to 2 more times standing order. After that, I would need online medical direction and contact the hospital for further advice and further direction to assist with more. I'm going to look at the 5 rights of that medication. Okay, that's going to be in another video, but I'm going to go ahead and look at the 5 rights. I want to look at any contraindications to a medication. For example, activated charcoal. A contraindication would be that the patient has an altered level of consciousness, has no gag reflex, in other words, they're unable to swallow, and they're unable to protect their own airway. That is a contraindication to give activated charcoal. For nitroglycerin, one of a few contraindications for nitroglycerin was a patient that has consumed any sexually enhancing medications such as Viagra, Cialis, or Levitra within the past 48 hours or any type of intake of pulmonary hypertension medications such as Flolan, Rivotril, or Valtrex. That would be a contraindication. Now, with this medication, we're going to look at the administration process. A good example would be our EpiPen. Our EpiPen, we're going to go ahead and grab our EpiPen. We're going to make sure we remove the safety off of it, remove it from its packaging. The area in which we're going to inject that EpiPen would be the mid-lateral thigh using that vastus lateralis muscle. That would be the administration process. Now, once I have assisted or administered said medication, we're going to go ahead and look at the response. How did the patient respond to our medication? Did they get better? Did they get worse? Did they stay the same? Is the patient actually having an allergic reaction? For example, if a patient has been given aspirin, some patients are actually allergic to aspirin. They can actually have an allergic reaction. They would have hives, itching, swelling, and swelling of the throat. So how did they respond? Did they start having an allergic reaction? Obviously, we're going to have to deal with that if that should arise. Once I get my intervention in, I'm going to go ahead and reassess my patient. Now, for any stable patient, we're going to reassess at least every 15 minutes. 15 minutes for a stable patient. If our patient is unstable, we're going to go ahead and reassess them every 5 minutes at minimum. At minimum, every 5 minutes, if not sooner, for an unstable patient. Our reassessment is going to include several items. We're going to look at our AFPU, how physically awake our patient is. Has that changed? We're going to reassess GCS. We're going to reassess our ABCs. This could include our treatment. So if I delivered oxygen in my breathing, I'm going to reassess that oxygen. How is it going? I'm going to ask the patient, how is your breathing? Now, I'm going to reassess my vital signs. Vital signs, once again, every 15 minutes for a stable patient, every 5 minutes for an unstable patient. All of my vital signs, once again. I'm going to reassess my treatment. I'm going to reassess my treatment, meaning, for example, the EpiPen that we just talked about. Do I see any hives? Do I see any swelling? Does the patient state that they're getting better? So how is my epinephrine working for the patient? And then I'm going to do a modified secondary assessment. As we did a modified secondary assessment, with our inspect, palpate, and auscultate, part of this modified secondary assessment is going back to that verbal assessment. For example, chest pain. So initially, my patient's chest pain was an 8 out of 10. Part of my modified secondary assessment would be to ask my patient, what is your pain now after I assisted you with your nitroglycerin? On a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being the worst pain possible, what's your pain now? It's a 4. Okay, now I went from an 8 down to a 4.